So very good afternoon, everybody. So I hope we are good to start. Yeah. So we broadly covered, what was the situation pre-GST on the indirect taxes and how it is looking like in GST and what is the broad impact that can, be there on your sector. And the biggest word or scare that we all have is compliance. So we've covered most of it, and we'll run through this. And I'll be happy to take questions in between, or you can just stop me anywhere and ask questions. So in the pre-GST regime, we had many taxes. We had different taxes at different points. Like we had custom duty, which is applicable on import of goods into India, and there were different set of rules, different set of rates which were applicable, different varieties of taxes within custom duty. Like you had the basic custom duty, you had the special additional duty, you had CVD, you had SAD, you had CESS, so on and so forth. So many things were there within custom duty itself, and then you had excise duty whenever you procure anything from manufacturers within India. Broadly, this rate was 12.5%, and there were specific concessional rates or exemptions in specific situations. Service tax was again a biggest, biggest word or biggest challenge pre-GST regime. There were multiple services which were getting taxed, multiple classification rates, and complications by itself. There was something called R&D cess, which was whenever you imported technology into India, then you would be required to pay 5% rate broadly. And then entry tax was there. Again, this was a local levy or a state levy, which was applicable on specific goods whenever they entered into that particular state. And then the VAT and CST, which was applicable whenever there is a supply of goods intra-India, between two states or within the same state. So we had to deal with so many number of taxes, so many compliances under each law, different acts and rules had different valuation schemes, different rates, different forms, audits, and so on and so forth. So it was very, very cumbersome and complicated. And therefore, this thought of GST was contemplated very, very long ago. And finally, we are seeing the reality now. So these were the rates broadly. So custom duty we had in the range of 7.5 or 10, and then special excise duty was 12.5%, cess 3%, SAD 4%. Excise was always 12, and most of the goods are under 12.5% category, barring certain concessional rates and exemptions. VAT was ranging from 5 to 15%, depending upon the products. CST was a concessional rate at the rate of 2%, provided you had those C forms. I'm sure you all would be aware there is a concept called concessional duty or concessional tax whenever a form which is called C form has to be issued, in which case it was 2%. Otherwise, it would be whatever VAT rate which is applicable to that product in that particular state. That was the rate applicable. Service tax was effectively 14.5%, plus there was an additional cess of 0.5%. Entry tax was ranging from 1 to 14% depending upon the state and the product, and research and development cess was 5%. So these were all the taxes. Now all this got subsumed into something called GST, goods and service tax. So GST in India is a dual GST. So you will always have to pay on any particular transaction two taxes, central GST and state GST. Either you call it central and state as it is, or you call it combinedly called integrated GST. So it depends on whether it is an interstate transaction or intrastate transaction that this terminology will differ, but effectively you will pay the same rate and same amount. Broadly, the rates have been categorized into 5 buckets. So one is nil rate, 5%, 12%, standard rate, which is 18% and 28%. And there is a cess additionally on certain products, which are called sin goods additionally. What remains out of GST is basic custom duty, petrol, alcohol, power, and land-related transactions. Credit has been, a very good, a welcome change as far as GST is concerned. So credit of all expenses incurred for the business is available under GST. Of course, you have to be in a business which is taxable, and then this benefit can be reaped. otherwise it becomes an additional cost. There is a cross-utilization permitted between CGST versus IGST or IGST versus CGST, same is the case with SGST, but cross-utilization between CGST and SGST is not possible. There are rules which have been defined called place of supply rules. Now, what happened under GST is that each state is treated as a separate taxable territory. If we want to understand it a little more simply, that each state, wherever there are operations, has to be treated as a separate territory as compared to the other state. So suppose we have an operation in Telangana and an operation in AP, then both of them are under falling under the same legal entity, but still for GST levy purposes, both of them have to be treated as separate entities. And any transactions between both these states would be subject to GST, even in spite of them being under the same legal entity. So this is one of the major complications that are there in GST right now. So to define now which state which will get revenue, these rules have been defined, which is called place of supply rules. So based on where the goods are delivered or where the services are provided, or there are different categories of transactions, if there is an immovable property, then where is the place of supply in relation to that immovable property? Or if there's an event, then there could be a separate place of supply in relation to that event. So there are different rules laid out for goods and services. Depending upon those rules, you have to decide what is the place of supply and treat it as an intrastate supply or an interstate supply. So just to simplify, I'll just give you an example here. So for example, you have a business meeting, say in a state, say Delhi, and we don't have any operation there, so we don't have a registration there. And obviously, we are going to stay there for 2-3 days, we are going to incur GST. So since a hotel is an immovable property, it falls under a rule where the POS will apply to immovable property, and the POS will be the location where the property is located. Since it is located in Delhi, the hotel is going to charge us CGST and SGST. So local CGST and SGST will be chargeable on us. Now when we go there, he will give us a bill, CGST, SGST, place of supply Delhi. We come back to Hyderabad, we cannot take the credit of that because the place of supply is in Delhi. So these rules become very important. One, to decide whether it's an intrastate or interstate supply. Two is whether to take credit, or whether you're eligible to take credit or not take credit, or it will become a cost for us. Then there are the what is the valuation? So valuation primarily is what we charge the customers, that becomes the valuation for levying GST, except in a situation where there are transactions with related parties. If there's a transaction with a related party, then we have to decide what is the fair value of that particular product or a service and pay GST on that value. There are also separate valuation rules prescribed in relation to stock transfers of goods or provision of services between two states, that is one office providing service to another office, or transferring goods from one location to another location, transferring capital goods from one location to another location. So those different valuation rules are there, and we need to follow those rules also. What is the time of supply? Now for goods, under the pre-GST regime, there was never a tax on advances. So whenever you paid advances, there was no tax, either VAT or excise or, you know, customs. There was never a tax which is required to be paid. Only on the invoice which is raised by the vendor, there was a tax which was required to be paid. Under GST, even if you pay an advance, you will have to pay tax, which will not be available as credit in any case. And then services, the rule is whether the invoice or the payment, whichever is earlier, that is there even under the service tax legislation. So there's not much change on that front. So broadly, the impact on the sector is that, you know, electrical energy is outside GST. And so therefore, this entry is still falling under the state list. And therefore, only the states have the power to charge taxes, the local taxes, and GST is not having the power. There was a lot of, representation from the industry to bring it into the GST regime so that you don't lose out on credits. But this has not been accepted, and therefore power remains outside the GST law. Therefore, now considering that all your inputs or all your capital goods or all your services that you procure, they were under different concessional rates and duties pre-GST regime. Now all those concessions are going away. have gone away actually, and therefore the standard rate which is applicable to those products which is defined as per the tariff, those rates will apply, which are in effect a little more as compared to what we had pre-GST regime, which, and therefore since energy is outside GST, we cannot take input tax credit from our business, and therefore this effectively is increase in cost of the business. So this on the, these were the exemptions broadly under the current, I mean under the pre-GST regime. There was an exemption for all the renewable sector. There were a lot of exemptions under the customs and excise, where there were concessional duties or nil rated duties whenever you're importing goods or buying from other manufacturers. Now the also you had the C form where you could import or buy, sorry, not import, but buy from local vendors at 2% rate. Now, even the C form is not there. So whatever standard rate is applicable, you are supposed to pay the standard rate and you are going to incur that cost. Plus also there was a concept called in transit sale. So what used to happen is that you used to, whenever somebody used to sell you a product, he will buy and he will sell in transit to any electricity generation business, in which case the CST is applicable only in the first leg, and the second leg that it is not applicable. So therefore now that concept also is not there, and therefore at both the legs GST will be incurred, and which is not applicable, which is not available as credit, and therefore this is effectively increasing a cost on your procurements. So there were so this slide talks about various exemptions that you had, like there was an excise duty general exemption under 12/2012 notification under different entries. So all these products were falling under a nil category. So these are the rates which are there under GST now. These are the VAT rates again pre-GST regime. Different states broadly they were all falling under 5% or 5.5% category. The renewable energy devices, components, windmills, devices for windmills, etc. So broadly what we discussed, we have summarized here saying that electricity generation is exempt or it is not under the purview of GST, and there are no exemptions or concessions available on supply procurement of energy or under the GST law on the procurement side. There is also no exemption for services procured for setting up the power plant or the project, and works contracts are classified as services and the rate will be 18%. BCD will continue to be exempted wherever you are having exemptions currently. So there's a import duty called basic custom duty which is there today also, which will continue post GST, which will, wherever there's an exemption or a concessional duty rate available, that is going to remain, and there we have a neutral impact. But wherever we had additional duty exemption, like the central excise or SAD exemptions also we had, whenever you imported any particular capital goods or any inputs, that will go away and we will have to pay IGST on import, which will not be available as credit. So for this is for businesses who can avail credit. So in what situations you can avail credit and what situation you need to have all these documents. So one is we need to have a document called tax invoice, which has to be there, or a debit note. Second is we need to receive the goods or services. Without receiving the goods, we just receive an invoice, we cannot take the credit. So therefore, when you pay an advance and the vendor is going to charge GST, he is going to pay GST, but we will not be eligible to take credit immediately until he is issuing a tax invoice to us. Tax has to be paid to the government, so the vendor is supposed to pay tax to the government, and he is also supposed to file a return. Unless all these conditions are fulfilled, we cannot take credit under the GST regime. So credits matching concept has become very, very complicated for a lot of industries. So currently under the tax, I mean pre-GST regime, what used to happen is when we used to claim credit, it was just a paper return in one two-pager or three-pager return. We just used to declare what is the credit, what is the turnover, what is the tax payable, and we just choose to pay the net tax amount. Under GST, it is going to be invoice level information that we need to upload. So what happens is vendor, step one will be vendor has to upload his sales details on the GST network, post which that will automatically be downloaded or available for the buyers under GSTR 2A, which we can select or deselect whether it is available to us or not. Suppose we are only into generation of electricity, then we cannot take credit. So we need to deselect all those items on the GST portal. And then if we have some other business activity which is taxable or which is subject to GST, then we can take proportionate credit if it is a common procurement, or if it is a procurement pertaining only to that business, we will be eligible for credit. So we need to do a lot of activity surrounding that and tick or select or deselect what is available and what is not available to us on a monthly basis. And similarly, whenever we are doing business apart from generation of electricity, we will upload our GSTR1 details, that is the revenue details, and our customers will be able to take credit online automatically by doing the similar activity. So this is becoming a very complicated process post GST, and therefore multiple companies are coming up with ASP solutions so that this process can be automated by the industry. So this is on the credit again, how you can set off credit. So whenever you buy something, these are the broad taxes that you pay: CGST, SGST, UTGST or IGST. All these taxes, CGST is applicable whenever you buy something from within the state. SGST is also the same thing. UTGST is applicable whenever you buy something from the union territories, wherever the place of supply is in the same union territory. IGST is integrated GST, which is applicable, one, on imports, two, on interstate purchases or sales. So all these taxes can be adjusted against our liabilities towards CGST, against CGST or IGST, SGST against SGST or IGST, UTGST again against UTGST or IGST, and IGST can be adjusted against any tax. So there is a complete flexibility here. The only thing which is not permitted is CGST cannot be utilized against SGST, and SGST cannot be utilized against CGST. So that cross utilization is not permitted here. So these are the rates for various renewable energy devices. So broadly the rates are coming under 5% category. Devices and parts for biogas, solar power based devices, solar power generation system, windmills, waste to energy, solar lanterns, so all these are coming under 5% category. And these are the rates on services which are broadly applicable to you. Most of them are falling under 18%. The installation, assembly, erection services, electrical installations, electricity transmission is outside, I mean it is exempt as of now. Engineering services, contract staffing services, security services, more or less everything is falling under 18%. If you incur something on goods transport agency services, then that will be subject to 5% rate. So this is a summary of the impact basically. It is an adverse impact, obviously. Removal of exemptions. So various exemptions have been removed as far as non-BCD is concerned, and therefore that cost is increasing. Increase in tax rates also. So service tax, for example, today is 15%. Post GST, it is going to become 18%. So there itself, it's a straight increase of 3% on all the procurement of services because we are not able to take credit. And the forms, removal of forms, the C forms, and the in transit sale concept also has been removed. So all this is leading to a negative impact on the sector. There are certain concepts again which will lead to compliance burden. So one is, we will not, if we are only into generation of electricity, we will not be able to take credit. That is one impact on the financial side. In any case, plus there is a burden of compliances whenever we procure it from unregistered dealers. So suppose you buy anything from registered dealers, he is going to charge you GST and you just don't take the credit of that. But if you procure anything from unregistered dealers, then you are supposed to pay tax and a reverse charge. So that is an additional compliance here, and which will again not be available as credit to you. Then there are advances. Wherever there are advances, you have to pay GST, and this is a working capital. I mean, it's a cost in any case for you additionally. Procurement of services and reverse charge. Again, if you procure, apart from unregistered dealers, there's a list of services under which you are supposed to pay tax and a reverse charge. So that's an additional compliance burden. So some of the examples are, you know, independent directors or, you know, advocates or goods transport agencies where we will have to fulfill reverse charge obligations. So what we can, what is, as a business, what you can do to at least minimize some cost is that we can talk to vendors, we can see where they're making benefit out of GST, because there will be a lot of vendors, say suppose they're traders today, they will not be eligible to take credit of excise duty and service tax into the pre-GST regime. Post-GST, there is no concept called manufacturer. Every transaction is subject to GST, and every business can be, they can take all the credits in relation to their procurement. So therefore, for your vendors to some extent, because the credits would have increased, their cost would have come down. And therefore, it is time for you to at least talk to the vendors and see how the pricing can be renegotiated based on this. And this can be supported by anti-profiteering law, where, you know, the government itself said that in case of increased credits for any particular business, then the same has to be passed on to the customers. There is also a concept called mixed supply and composite supply. So we need to evaluate from procurement side. This happens in a case where there is a combination of goods and combination of services provided, and this will happen most likely in EPC contracts. You have to decide whether it is a mixed supply or a composite supply. It could happen that the vendor may classify it wrongly and pay extra tax or at a higher rate of tax. Therefore, it is very important at least to identify key vendors or where we incur a lot of cost to see whether it is really a mixed supply, composite supply, what is the rate of tax that he should apply. Because if he applies 28% instead of 18%, then there itself it's like a huge burden on us. And then we'll have to do a lot of, all the PO identification and GST vendor identification and create separate codes wherever they're procuring. Wherever you're procuring from different states of the same vendor, all that identification and mapping has to be done. That is from the procurement side. And contracts have to be amended accordingly based on all these points. One point that you may consider is wherever we are procuring goods, and because we can't take credits, we can evaluate buying from composition vendors because the rate will be less. If the same product is subject to 18% from a registered vendor, the same product could be chargeable at 1% if you procure from a composition vendor. So whether we can do that is some planning that you can think about. So this is on the registration. So basically there is a process and by which you need to register yourself under GST. So that's called a migration process. So existing registration will be there, and you'll get a registration provisionally under form GST 21. And then based on that, we need to apply for the original registration in form 20. And if all the details are correct, then they will issue a certificate of registration in original in form 6. Otherwise, they will issue an intimation asking for more details, etc. And then we need to submit, and then we will get the final registration certificate. And this registration certificate needs to be displayed at the entrance of your business premises. So registration has to be obtained in every place, wherever, every state, wherever we have a place of business. The threshold for registration is 20 lakhs of revenue. So whoever is crossing 20 lakhs of revenue will be required to obtain a registration. There is only one common registration for all three taxes, CGST, SGST, IGST. And wherever there are two premises or two business places in one state, then you can take two separate registrations or one single registration. It's an option given to the company. Jammu and Kashmir is clarified now. It is part of the whole GST regime in India. And all the compliances have to be taken care of for all the states separately. So separate return has to be filed for each state, separate compliances, audits, annual returns, everything has to be done separately for each of those states. There is also called a concept input service distributor. So suppose we have operations in 3 or 4 states and some of the businesses are creditable for us or taxable, and therefore we can take credits assuming. Then there is a concept called input service distribution, where there could be one state where we will procure all common services like management consulting or IT support and audit or some common services like these. And those service, whatever credit we take on that, has to be distributed to various states. So that is one more complicated concept introduced here, which needs to be done on a monthly basis. So this is an additional compliance again here. So this is the list of returns that we need to file. GSTR1 is all outward supplies, that is the sale details, which is to be submitted by 10th of the next month. GSTR2 is all the procurement data. So most of this data will be automatically uploaded by the vendor, and we need to just accept or reject this. This needs to be done by 15th. Then there is a monthly return. Whatever liability needs to be paid, that needs to be paid by 15th. By 20th, and the monthly return needs to be filed by 20th. And then compounding taxpayer is only composition dealer, so that is a quarterly return. There is a return for ISD, which we discussed. It is on 15th of the subsequent month. There's a return for TDS. There are some transactions which could be subject to tax called tax deducted, so it's part of GST. There is still no notification on what transactions will be subject to TDS as of now. There's an annual return which needs to be filed by 31st December, and then the final return is only when there's a cancellation of registration. So these are the broad returns which are required to be filed. So GSTR 1, 2, 3 and 9 are mandatory for every business, so therefore these are highlighted here. So this is the manner of matching which we discussed in the previous slide, that when the vendor submits the details, we need to accept or reject, and these are the timelines which are there here. So we can just skip this. So payments are all common across all the states. 20th is the due date for payment, so we need to enable our IT systems to handle the payments, the filing of the returns and everything. Waybills are being the GST law per se has deferred waybills, but respective states have been given the powers to manage the waybill generation and rules relating to waybills, and each of the states are releasing their waybill rules, and AP has done that recently. Telangana has not yet done that. Statutory forms are done away with. Refunds are available in two situations under GST law. One is when you export any goods or services. Second is wherever there's an inverted duty structure, which means your tax rate, output rate, is lesser than your input rate, in which case you will have credit balance which you cannot use, and therefore a refund would be granted in that situation. So these are the key action items. Get all the registration and IDs and passwords for GST, sharing those registration to the stakeholders, customer and vendor details updation, and impact assessment obviously, and do the vendor negotiation. These are all the documents which are required under GST under different situations. So invoice is basically whatever invoice format you have today, we have to see whether that invoice format is in line with GST law and make those changes in the format. Debit notes and credit notes, again, today we may just issue a debit note or a credit note whenever we want to pass on some discount or we want to revise the price, etc. Post GST, each invoice or each debit note has to be linked to the invoice. It cannot be random and it cannot be ad hoc. It has to be linked to the invoice, and each invoice can have only one debit note or a one credit note. So therefore, this is very important. Whenever we receive advance, there's a document which we need to issue called receipt voucher. Again, there is a specific format for this, and we need to follow that format. And then, of course, returns. Returns are very complicated, and therefore our IT has to be totally prepared for handling, you know, return-related compliances. Otherwise, a lot of work will have to be done manually, and there could be errors given that this is a new law. And yeah, the P&L account has to be maintained state-wise, at least for MIS purposes, or at least for handling GST-related compliances, because under the GST law, we also need to reconcile what we are reporting in the returns with the financials. And so therefore, it becomes important for us to have something state-level to prove that. So this is broadly what It is, and I would be happy to take questions.